With Yah Righteousness, Jerusalem, and the Holy See, peace everyone, and Yah bless. I hope everybody is in great health, and hope you're focused and, reading, study, praying, and doing. Again, for Yah Righteousness, Jerusalem, and the Holy See. Today I'm going to deal with some things dealing with the financial situation that's going on in the world, how dire it is, and hopefully those of you out there who hear this, if you're able, you can go and listen to these conversations yourself. Max Kaiser, his interview with Alistair McLeod, April 29th and May 2nd, today. He did a part one and a part two. You can bring these the report that Alistair McLeod did. It came out on April 20th. And if you can pull it up and print it out, it's good to have. That's what we've done, and I'm going to read it to you today. Also, a interview that we listened to with James Rickard, R-I-C-K-A-R-D-S, James Rickards. He did an interview with London Real, R-E-A-L. It's about an hour and 24 minutes long. You pull it up on the internet, you can see they've got it in some pieces. They got one piece, it's like 7 minutes and like 54 seconds. You can listen to that, which is part of that hour and like 24 minute interview. We listen to the whole thing. But if you can, pull it up, listen to it. It's informative, okay? And again, James Rickard is an authority per se in what's going on in the world situation economically. You know, they'll use the term global, which we try to stay away from because it's a mind game, right? But nevertheless, I'm going to read the interview with Alistair McLeod. Matter of fact, not so much the interview, but the report he put out. He put out two, and I'm going to read them both. Make some comments about, what I see in regards to prophecy. Also, while I'm thinking about it, the Democracy Now! Shows for April 5th, April 25th and 26th, May 1st and May 2nd. Those are Democracy Now! Shows. I'm sure many of you or all of you are watching Democracy Now! Yourself. And it's good to watch because sometimes they just have a little piece here, a little piece there on some of the shows. I don't, say to go and watch those particular shows because it's just a little bit. But, generally when I mention a show on Democracy Now!, it's more than just like 5 or 10 minutes. Usually it's a little longer, it's informing. It should be very beneficial to whatever extent for those to watch. Now, last month, in the Q&A in part one, Yadida mentioned about Yaakov being 91 years old when Yosef was born. And I said I wasn't, that was a good point, and I had to look into it. I mentioned it again part two last month in the Q&A, I think it was, possibly in the session itself. And so Yadida found this on the internet, sent it to us. I've read it. Some of the things that are on here is a little bit, again, shaky to me. But nevertheless, some of the things are valid without a doubt. And what we've come to find out, and again, if you want to go there and look at it for yourself, I think the how you would Google it is hiswordsarepure.com. I'm not sure who's putting this up. That's all we were able to come up with. Again, whoever he, she, they are, hiswordsarepure.com. And they got the life of Jacob, the life of Yaakov, right? And in reading it, then I realized my mistake in not seeing this, you know, and really not grabbing it when, you know, to actually see this, okay? And the key to me is, and I'll take you back here to Genesis, right? And when you go back to Genesis chapter 27, you'll see right at the beginning of chapter 27, Genesis, right? And it came to pass. That's what I had been missing. And when you see this, it came and it came to pass. And it's in many places, Genesis through Malachi in the Book of Remembrance, where you'll see this phrase, it and it came to pass. I denoted here a few months ago in dealing with the 33rd chapter of Exodus. Okay? And dealing with that 33rd chapter in verse 3 where it says, let me read it to you verbatim. It says, matter of fact, not the Exodus. It's the Book of Numbers, 33rd chapter in the Book of Numbers. Okay. Okay, the 33rd chapter in the Book of Numbers, verse 3, but I'm going to pick it up from verse 1, right? And these are the journeys of the children of Israel, which went forth out of the land of Egypt with their armies under the hand of Moshe and Aharon, right? And Moshe wrote their goings out according to their journeys by the commandment of Yah. And these are their journeys according to their goings out. Verse 3, and they departed from Ramesses in the first month, on the 15th day of the first month, on the morrow after the Passover, the children of Israel went out with a high hand in the sight of all the Egyptians. And again, this word morrow, as we've, you know, denoted a few months back and in the past, even before a few months back, we have talked about it in the past. This word morrow, when you look it up, it can mean tomorrow. But in this text here, in this way it's being used here, it doesn't mean tomorrow in the next 24-hour period. Okay? Again, when you look it up in the Strong's Exalted Concordance, when it directs you to the another place where, about this, the definitions for morrow, and it can and does mean in this place here, deferred time. Okay? Which means it can be a minute later, an hour later, 7 hours later, 7 days later, 7 months later, 7 years later. Okay? That's deferred time. And in this instance here, it just meant that they came out after Passover that night, as we've said in the past, right? Wasn't that long after Passover, okay, ended that they came out. You can see that in regards to children of Israel coming out of Egypt in Exodus chapter 12. I think that's verse 32, 33 in the chapter 12, Exodus, right? When it says the Egyptians were urgent upon them, so they came out soon after Passover ended that night, okay? Not the next 24-hour day, okay? Which was the 15th, okay? you know, of the month of Abib, or, you know, the first month of the year, in regards to what Yah told Moses, you know, in the 12th chapter Exodus, right? This will be the beginning of months. So they came out right after Passover ended, you know, on the 15th day that night. Okay, again, every 24-hour period begins with dark, followed by light. Again, Genesis chapter 1, right? Okay, now when you go back over here to Genesis chapter 27, and again, this phrase, and it came to pass, it's like Morrow in the 33rd chapter, Numbers, verse 3. When you see it, and it came to pass, it can mean, you know, the next minute, the next hour, the next day, the next month, the next year, the next 20 years, the next 50 years. You understand what I'm saying? And in this regard, it's a lot of years that had came, you know, gone by from the time that, when we look at this last verse in chapter 26, Exodus, matter of fact, the last couple of verses, right? And it says, when you pick it up at verse 34 in chapter 26, Exodus, and Esau was 40 years old when he took to wife Judith, or Judith, daughter of Beeri the Hittite, and Bashemat, the daughter of Elon, or Elon the Hittite, right? Which were a grief of mind unto Isaac and to Rebekah. And it was from there that I was looking at, they were 40 years old, and I was taking it from there, which again, that's where I was off. That was my mistake. When you go into chapter 27, and it says, and it came to pass that when Isaac was old and his eyes were dim so that he could not see, he called Esau, his eldest son, and said unto him, my son. And he said unto him, behold, here am I. Okay. In actuality, we know now that Jacob and Esau, they were 77 years old when this happened. Okay. So 37 years had passed. And that's what this, and it came to pass, represents here. Okay, in Genesis chapter 27. After you finish reading chapter 26, Genesis, and you see in verse 34 and 35. Okay, follow what I'm saying? It's 37 years that had passed. Because now they're 77 years old, Esau and Jacob, when this was said. Okay, Esau by Isaac, his father. All right. The boys are twins, so they're 77 years old. And we also know that Jacob, when he went, was sent to Haran, okay, to his mother's brother's, you know, Laban's house. He was 77, and he spent 7 years there, right, working for his uncle for Rachel to become his wife. And when that situation happened, he was 84. And we know about what happened, right? His uncle played the trick on him, you know, sent Leah in unto him, right? More likely, again, she was veiled. He didn't recognize her. But he had intercourse with her, and then the veil came off. I'm told, okay, you're cold, right? And he was highly upset. And so Laban told him, said, you know, it's not the custom that we give the younger before the elder. So you take the elder first, which he already had intercourse with her. He said, now you fulfill her week, 7 days, and then I'm going to give you, you know, who he actually worked the 7 years for, Rachel. And so now, you know, after a week, now he's got Rachel, he takes her to wife. And again, as I said, Jacob knew the law of Yah. He knew that was incorrect, but he violated it anyway, right? And, you know, probably justified it because he worked for Rachel. He had been tricked, but he knew the law of Yah. You know, he knew you're not supposed to take two sisters, all right? But he did, and this added to his grief of mind over the years and the things that he went through. But nevertheless, he didn't start having intercourse and creating a family. I didn't start giving him a family until he was 84. And we know from reading, you know, in the book that Yahoseph was the last child born to him before they left Padan Aram, Haran. Okay? Benjamin was born later on. Okay? You know, it's still a little, you know, hairy in there about actually when Benjamin was born. The way I'm looking at it, he was born about 8 years later. In this rundown, if you bring it up and look at it, they've got him born about 4 years later. But like I said, you know, that could be right. I'm kind of looking at it as about 8 years later when the code was 99. Okay. That's when Benjamin was born. And that's when Raquel died, giving birth to Benjamin. Because I look at it that, you know, Yosef was about 8 or 9 years old when his youngest brother, you know, and the last boy that Yaakov had was born. Yaakov about 99 years old when Benjamin was born, okay? And that would have made Yosef 8 years old. And then 9 years later, okay, about when Yosef was about, I mean, when Yaakov was about, 107 to 108 years old, that's when, you know, again, Yosef being 17, that's when he was, you know, he went into bondage, captivity, you know, and was taken down into Egypt. And I would look at Benjamin being about 8 or 9 years old when that happened. And then 22 years later, I would see Benjamin being about 29, 30 years old. And Yosef being 39. Okay? See, so that's how I see it. But, you know, like I said, if you want, you can go there and pull that up. And again, that was hiswordsarepure.com. You can see the life of Yaakov, and you can maybe, you know, make a copy and go over it yourself. And like I said, they've got a chart. And the chart, this is the chart here. It's a color-coded chart, okay? And you can go through it and check that out. And, yeah, and they make some excellent points. Like I said, they make some excellent points. Again, they've done some assuming, as they tell you. You know, a lot of it was, you know, put together on assumptions. But they tell you that. Okay, and that's the good thing. They tell you that. And so you can go in there and check it out. As I went through it, I noticed they went over into Hebrews, and you'll see that on page 1 in the second paragraph. And you know, anytime somebody goes over into the New Testament, pulling something out of the New Testament, it makes me suspect. Okay? Because I know that New Testament is a bunch of nonsense. So, you know, but again, like I said, you go check it out. But now we know unequivocally that Yaakov was 84 when he took the two sisters to wife. That's when he started to have a family at 84 years old. Okay, and again, the key phrase in that Genesis chapter 27 at the top of the chapter is, "And it came to pass." Okay, and when you see "and it came to pass," you know, you have to discern now, you know, how much time has gone by, because you don't know. Like I said, it's like that word "morrow" in the 33rd chapter, Numbers, verse 3. It can mean, you know, any length of time. When it says on the morrow, you know, it's deferred time. When you see "and it came to pass," that's deferred time. And you don't necessarily, it doesn't necessarily mean any particular amount of time. You're going to have to, you know, research it. And, you know, as these, you know, people did, whomever they may be, and they saw it. And again, you know, thank God that he brought that to our attention. Again, Yadida saw it when she just subtracted the 17 years from Yaakov being 39 years from Yaakov. You know, Yosef was 39 years old, right? From the 130 years that Yaakov was, or Israel was, when he went into Egypt. And you subtract that 39 years, you know, the age of Yosef, right? Again, it was 5 years of famine left. He already had the 7 years of plenty. We know Yosef, according to the book, was lifted up out of the dungeon and set up over Egypt by Pharaoh when he was 30. So they had the 7 years of the plenty, as he's 37, and they were 2 years completed into the famine when he revealed himself to his brothers. So it was 5 years left, so he was 39. And again, when they went back and they all came down, all Israel came down into Egypt, we know Yaakov, Israel, was 130, so you subtract that 39 from 130, you get 91. So that's when Yosef was born. And if you go back and you look at those other children, you know, because some of them overlap, because again, we know Leah, you know, Raquel gave Yaakov her handmaid, and he bore with her. Then Leah gave Yaakov her handmaid, he bore with her. So some of those children's lives overlap. They deal with that in this document, the life of Yaakov. And again, they basically say that all these children were born, including Dinah, okay? Those first 11 boys and the girl were born, per se, basically within the first 5.5 years, you know, they were born in that, you know, length of time. All of them, except Benjamin. He was born later. And, you know, so, like I said, they give their reasons and whatnot. If you can pull it up, go there and look at it, check it out, for yourself. But again, the essence of it is that we know now that Yaakov was 77 years old, as was Esau when the blessing came down. Okay, the blessing on Yaakov, okay, that he would have the dominion, and eventually he would lose the dominion, because again, as we've talked about in the past, his descendants would turn away from Yah, as when I talked about last month, was in the book of Deuteronomy, right? And we see that's what Yah had conveyed to Moses. And Moses conveyed that to the children of Israel in Deuteronomy chapter 30, right? As well as Deuteronomy chapter 32, how they were going to go into these new idols and images, not Yah, but devils, right? You know, and that was all these religions of man and idols and images that would pop up, you know, as time would go by. And as we've denoted in the past, you know, you had Buddhism that popped up in the first kingdom of man, the Babylonian kingdom. You had, from what I understand, right, you had Zoroastrianism that came about in the second kingdom of man, the Medo-Persian kingdom. You had Judaism and other idols like Serapis that came along in the third kingdom of man, the Greek kingdom. And then quite naturally, you've had a plethora of religions that have popped up in the fourth kingdom of man, the diverse kingdom, Daniel chapter 7, right? We know Christianity, Islam, Scientology, you know, you've had different denominations out of Christianity and Islam that have popped up in this fourth kingdom. All this stuff is new. And again, as we said, when you go to Daniel chapter 2 and really look at that, and examine Daniel chapter 2, that everything that was invented, everything that was conceived of the ways of man, the ways of the heathen, right, which we're told to let go of in your remnant chapter 10, right? In essence, it says, learn not the ways of the heathen, for the customs of the people are vain, worthless. But again, when you go to Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 15 through 67, you see that Israel was to be raised in the ways of the heathen. You follow what I'm saying? That was part of the curse, was it not? So, again, once we awaken, if we seek Yah out and we awaken, right, then we go into this book of remembrance, so-called Old Testament, and really read it, okay? At some point, we have to decide, are we going to turn to Yah with all our heart and soul and serve Yah or not? And then once you really read this book of remembrance, so-called Old Testament, Genesis through Malachi, then if you really read it all the way through and you discern it, and you start to take on the attributes, the ways of Yah, the ways of His laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts, you are able to differentiate, discern between the ways of the heathen and the ways of Yah, which we have to be able to do, to discern who's serving Yah and who's not serving Yah, which again is Malachi chapter 3, 16 through the 18th verse, which Yah said that those of us who would return to Yah, return to Him, we would be able to do. So again, when we do this, you know, actually read this book of remembrance, you will acquire that ability to discern and differentiate between the way of God and the way of man, the way of the heathen. And then we have to let the way of the heathen, the way of man, go and embrace the way of God. And once we do that with all our heart and all our soul, then we have actually done an about face. We have actually returned to Yah, which we see in Deuteronomy chapter 30, right? With all our heart and all our soul. And that's when Yah remembers the covenant that He made with our fathers. And that's when Yah brings us back. Those of us, you know, who actually embraces His laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts with all our heart and soul, submit and obey. That's when He starts to, in actuality, break us down and starts to refine us, okay, and rework us, predicated on the sure foundation, Yeshayah chapter 28. And that's a process in itself. And He makes us into His new sharp threshing instruments, having teeth. And that's when we become a sign for Yah, to who and whomever, you know, knows us, sees us, or is around us for, you know, any period of time. They will see that we don't operate like everybody else, okay? Because now we're putting Yah before us, His laws, His statutes, or His judgments, commandments, and precepts. Again, the law is light, right? Proverbs chapter 6. And so we put that light before us, and Yah directs us in the way that we should go when we apply that law. Again, we were told in Deuteronomy by Moses, right? This is not a vain thing unto us, right? This law of Yah. This was our wisdom and understanding, our light in the sight of the nations and the people of the earth. Okay? So we are to, you know, utilize the law, right? Employ it, and use it to discern everything and everybody, right? And when we would do this, Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 3, that then Yah would remember the covenant He made with our fathers. And those of us who would do this, He would bring back. You know, Amos 9, that He would sift us away from who and whomever we would be around who's not about Yah's laws, statutes, or the judge's commandments and precepts. And He would bring us back, okay, after He refined us to a certain degree, okay? Not that we're a finished product, because we can't become a finished product, you know, definitely not in captivity, right? But the process of refinement begins in captivity. And we have to restrain sin and acquire a certain amount of spiritual, mental, physical growth, okay? And being adherent and submissive to God, our righteousness, the King, with all our heart and soul. And where this law of Yah and all the attributes of the law, like a breastplate of armor, okay? Our breastplate of righteousness, right? Yeshaya chapter 59. And then we put that helmet of salvation upon our head, right? And that's the faith, unequivocal faith that we put in Yah, our righteousness, the King, right? Again, Yeshaya chapter 50, right? Who walks in darkness, has no light, and obeys the voice of my servant, let them put their trust in the name of Yah and stand upon their strong in Yah of hosts, the King, okay? Because he's our righteousness, and his law, statutes, ordinance, judgments, commandments, and precepts, that is his righteousness. And so we gird ourselves up with Yah, our righteousness, you know, which is his laws, statutes, ordinance, judgments, commandments, and precepts. And that's what, when we do this, that's the putting on the breastplate of righteousness, and that's the refinement that takes place. Letting go of the ways of the heathen, the ways of man, which again we're told to do, Jeremiah chapter 10, right? And Proverbs 3:31. Okay, now, today we're, you know, this economic situation is very dire. And that's why we see America, you know, through the front man, that the Illuminati, Edomite of the West, and you know, has put in, you know, up front, which is Donald Trump. And as if you pull those up, and I'm going to read, you know, this report by Alasdair MacLeod. In it, you'll hear me read it, but also if you look it up and listen to the interview with Max Kaiser, part one and part two, you'll hear Alasdair MacLeod say that Trump has done a complete about face from being a peacenik, if you will, right? Advocating peace, to now he's a warmonger. And the reason for this is the economic situation that America is in. Okay? Because America is in a dire situation economically. Here a few weeks ago, Max Kaiser did a show, him and Stacey Herbert. It was last month. I can't remember the exact day. But Max Kaiser said there are no more nations that America can con anymore. And more likely than not, it's one of the shows that he did after he read Alasdair MacLeod's report that came out April 20th. So possibly if you go back and look at Max Kaiser's shows from April 20th to the 29th, you know, it's before the 29th. It might be, like I said, that week prior. And go back and look at those shows, you'll probably see the show that I'm talking about, okay? And because this is what Alasdair MacLeod has got in his report, basically, right? That America has conned all of the nations over the years, okay, then it can con. It can't con anymore. You understand? It's seen now. Okay, it's totally undressed, America. It's butt naked. Okay, and again, using that terminology, I'll go here to chapter 47, Yeshaya, that we discussed in the past, and I'll read it. Come down and sit in the dust, O virgin daughter of Babylon. Sit on the ground. There is no throne, O daughter of the Chaldeans, for you shall no more be called tender and delicate. Okay? And this is talking about the United States of America. Okay? In other words, it is totally undressed. It's seen now, unequivocally. Okay? Take the millstones and grind meal. Uncover thy locks, make bare the leg. Uncover the thigh, pass over the rivers. Thy nakedness shall be uncovered. Yes, thy shame shall be seen. I will take vengeance, and I will not meet thee as a man. Because Yahweh is not a man. He is he who creates, the king, spirit and creator of all things. Fountain of living waters. Okay? Because all spirit issues from him. Okay? Verse 4. As for our Redeemer, Yahweh is his name, the Holy One of Israel. Sit thou silent and get thee into darkness, O daughter of the Chaldeans. See? Daughter. The next Babylon. Not the original. Okay? For you shall no more be called the Lady of Kingdoms. Okay? I was wroth with my people. I have polluted mine inheritance and given them into thine hand. Thou didst show them no mercy. Upon the ancient have you very heavily laid thy yoke. Okay? And we can see that that's been going on with Israel, you know, and definitely the descendants of Israel that were brought here, that's been going on here for a long time, right? Centuries, few centuries that we've been here in this country, right? Verse 7. And you said, I shall be a lady forever. That's you know, those who set this country up, which again, descendants of Esau per se, right? The illuminated Edomite, right? They basically, because they were looking for a place to come to that they could control, that was not up under any monarchy, okay? And again, as I've read not long ago, and just so you can get the gist on what I'm talking about, I'm going to read this again, and I'm going here to the Columbia Encyclopedia, right? And I'm going to the breakdown of the Jews, right? You look up Jews, and this is in the Columbia Encyclopedia, and they'll tell you the term Jews is from Judah, okay? But as we said here before, there is no tribe in the nation of Israel ever called Judah, okay? That's Esau's terminology, right? Because again, the fourth son of Jacob by Leah, as Leah, as it says in Genesis, you understand, when she had, Yah gave her the fourth son, she said, now will I praise Yah. Therefore, she named the boy Yahudah. Okay? So this changing of the name of, or should I say, the terminology from Yahudah to Judah was done by the descendants of Esau. Again, to keep man, and especially us, but man, period, from knowing, huh, the actual name of the Creator, Yahweh. Okay, they did not want us to know Yah's name. That's why they took it out of the book in over 6,800 places. Okay, so now, when you go down in this breakdown, and check this out. I'm going to just read the top of this, right? It says, Jews from Judah, okay, term used synonymously with Hebrews and Israelites. You hear that? Now again, Jacob, you know, his descendants are the Hebrew Israelites. Esau, his descendants are the Hebrew Edomites. So again, you know, this first connotation, right, synonymously with Hebrews, that's correct, because Esau is a Hebrew, right? The Edomites are Hebrews, but they're not Israel, right? Now check this. It says, to indicate the descendants of the tribes of Israel. See, that's a lie. You follow what I'm saying? That's Esau's spin. Said, adherents of the religion, Judaism. You hear that? Now, that's Esau. You follow what I'm saying? Is it the adherents of the religion, Judaism? And as I said a little bit ago, and as I said in the past, right, Judaism is religion. Didn't come on the scene till the third kingdom of man, the Greek kingdom. So again, when that, you know, Daniel chapter 2, right, when the kingdom, when the image of Nebuchadnezzar that represents the four kingdoms of man is destroyed, right, when that stone cut out of the mountain without hands, right, which is the movement of Yah, our righteousness to King, when it hits the image in the feet and toes, part iron, part clay, the image that represents the four kingdoms of man starts to break up, crumble, and is to be blown away till no parts of it remain in the earth. No parts. So that's all these, you know, inventions, right? All these religions that's been conceived of, all this new stuff, right? It's got to go out with the four kingdoms of man, right? None of that can go into the stone that after the stone hits, right, starts to grow into a mountain, which will fill up the whole earth. And then the whole earth will be the kingdom of God forever. Okay? And during this transition, people have to do what? They have to make a decision at some point, whether they're going to remain in those four kingdoms that are crumbling as I speak, or are they going to come into that stone, which is already growing into that mountain, that's going to fill up the whole earth. And when that takes place, then the whole earth will be the kingdom of Yah, our righteousness forever. He who creates, right? So they got to make a decision. So this is what's going on now, and that's going to become even more, you know, more pervasive, huh? And it's going to burgeon more and more as time goes by. And this is going to be, you know, it's not going to be no real long process, okay? All right, now, it says here, before the Second World War, the Jewish population scattered over the world amounted to 16 million. It is estimated that between 5 and 6 million Jews perished in massacres during the war. Okay, now again, so Esau, again, you understand, from the second one, he talked about himself. Okay, the descendants of Esau, right? That's that lie again about 6 million Edomites perished, you know, in Germany. You follow what I'm saying? Poland, whatnot. It's a bunch of nonsense. Okay, more than half the Jews use the Yiddish language. See, right? But Israel was not supposed to know they were Israel. You understand? For 2 days, Hosea 6, or 2,000 years, right? You follow what I'm saying? Again, when you go to Deuteronomy 28, right? It tells us there we were supposed to take on the ways of the heathen, the ways of man, the ways of whatever nation we were under or who was over us. You follow what I'm saying? And again, Yeshaya chapter 6, right? We were supposed to lose all remembrance of who we were, who we are. And again, that was the last 2,000 years from when it actually totally took place, where you didn't have an Israelite on this earth that knew they were Israel. So again, who are these people who have come up through time calling themselves Israel, calling themselves Hebrews, which they are, but also calling themselves Jews? That's the descendants of Esau. Again, from the from the twisting, right, and the a changing of the name of Yehuda to Judah, and they became Jews. You follow what I'm saying? But they're not Israel. Follow? And again, you understand? Because again, what is, if Israel was always going to know that they were Israel, huh? Then why do you have Yeshaya chapter 6? Why do you have Yeshaya chapter 44 at the top when Yah's talking about an awakening, the appointed spirit on the descendants of Israel that would seek him out, would search for him, and we would wake up and pop up like willows by the water courses? Okay? Not that all of us would understand, you know, the essence of truth when we awaken, because you're going to have, as it says in Daniel chapter 12, which also intimates a being asleep, right, per se, walking dead, Daniel 12 at the top, when we started to seek God in some shape, form, or fashion, when we started to awaken, some of us would awaken, huh, to everlasting life, right? Yah's going to take those back that turn to him with all their heart and soul, plant them in the land, huh, and we would bear what? Roots downward, branches upward. He's going to bring forth the holy children out of those of us who totally turn to Yah with all our heart. That's the everlasting life, right? Daniel chapter 12. But as it also says, but some to shame and everlasting contempt. And that's the ones of us who awaken and still hold on to, you know, these idols and images. You know, understand, Judaism in some shape, form, or fashion, Christianity in some shape, form, or fashion, Islam in some shape, form, or fashion. But nevertheless saying that they're Israel. Okay? And like I said, for those who hear me say Islam, we got one here in Chicago who calls himself an Israelite Moor. And how he got to that, I don't know, but that's what he calls himself. Okay? So nevertheless, you follow what I'm saying? You've got some that are going to awake, and they're going to turn to Yah with all their heart and soul. You got some going to awake, and they're not. And that's the awakening to the shame and everlasting contempt. Okay? See, but again, we see an awakening had to take place, right? And we also see this in Ezekiel chapter 37, don't we? Right? The Valley of Dry Bones. Right? An awakening is taking place. That's what that's talking about. See? And as I said in the past, you got some who say, well, it says there the whole house of Israel is going, that is representative of the whole house of Israel. Right. The whole house of Israel that awakens, that seek Yah out, that awakens and turns to Yah with all their heart and soul. That will be the whole house of Israel, Ezekiel 37. But all Israel is not, you understand, not only all Israel is not going to awake, all Israel, you understand, is not going back to Yah, because all Israel is not going away, because all Israel doesn't see Yah. And again, you go back to Yeshaya chapter 6, and you see there, right, only a tenth of the males of Israel are going to return. You know, going to return to Yah, come back. A tenth of the males. So that means, again, 9/10 or 90% of Israelite males in the world that they are not going to Yah. You're going to have more Israelite females, right? I have no doubt about that. But it's still not going to be all, nowhere near all Israelite females that are going to awaken and turn to Yah. Okay? All right. Now I'm still back here with this Jews, right? Now I'm not going to read all this. Now I'm going to cut to the chase, right? And go down here what I actually came here for. And when you go down here, I'm going to pick this up. I'm going to pick this up during the Greek kingdom, okay, which is the third kingdom of man. And it says the Jews were a strong religious group during the period of Hellenism, but regained political independence only under the Maccabees. Now, the Maccabees were Edomites, not Israel. So you see how they got this stuff intertwined here? Okay? And if you're not, you understand, if you're not able to discern, you know what I'm saying, what this is, who this is actually talking about, you get really confused. Because Esau's got, you know, their history intertwined with ours to a degree. But it's basically talking about him, the descendants of Esau. It says, strife between the Pharisees and the Sadducees ended in Roman intervention and complete dominance, and Jerusalem was finally destroyed in 70 AD. See, that's the Edomites. That's not talking about Israel at all there. That was the descendants of Esau. And again, that's Daniel chapter 11, verse 14. When the robbers of Israel tried to establish division, but they failed, as it was prophesied, right? Daniel 11, verse 14. Okay, this was the beginning of the development of their thought and law by scholars and rabbis. See, Edomites. It says, with the organization of new kingdoms upon the ruins of the Roman Empire, Jews appeared in Western Europe and began to play an important part in its intellectual and economic life. You hear that? In its intellectual and economic life. Okay? And again, this is coming up through the kingdoms now. Israel was to lose all understanding of who they were, walking dead. So who is this claiming to be Israel? The robbers of our people, the descendants of Esau, right? Okay, now, from the 9th to the 12th century, they enjoyed a golden age of library effluence, particularly in Spain. Efflorescence, particularly in Spain. Okay, you hear that? Now, they going 300-400 years here, the 9th to the 12th century. Now, again, this is not Israel, okay, because we weren't to know who we were. We supposed to go up under other people and be up under other people's, you understand, dominion and learn and take on the ways of other nations. That's the prophecy, is it not? Deuteronomy 28, 15 through 67. Says from the ninth to the 12th century. Okay, I read that right. From the time of the Crusades date the persecutions which were the lot of the Jew until the 18th century. Okay, and the Crusades what started around the 11th century. You follow what I'm saying? And lasted for a few hundred years. Okay, but it says from the time of the Crusades date the persecutions which were the lot of the Jew until the 18th century. The ownership of land and most of the occupations, save petty trading and money lending, were forbidden to them. You hear that? The ownership of land and most of the occupations, save petty trading and money lending, were forbidden to them. The ghetto came into existence. They who in Palestine had been an agricultural people became perforce an urban population. In Spain, some 100,000 Jews were killed towards the end of the 15th century. You hear that? That's 1492, right? Okay, it's going to be in here again in a minute, right? In 1290, the Jews were expelled from England. In 1392, from France. In 1492, from Spain. That's when that 100,000 got killed toward the end of the 15th century, right? Under Torquemada. In 1497, they got expelled from Portugal, okay? Many of the exiles perished. Others found asylum in Holland and in Turkish possessions. You hear that? The German Jews fled to Poland, but there too they suffered from persecutions. When a country suffered economically or in war, its Jews were likely to be its scapegoat. Now, that's what Esau got written here in this, okay? Talking about a scapegoat. But the people attacked them because they knew who was perpetrating this economic collapse on their countries. And this is what the world is experiencing now. Okay, again, what did it say in Genesis chapter 27? What did Isaac tell Esau, the original Esau? Huh? You're going to have the fatness of the earth and the dew of heaven also, but you're going to live by your sword. The sword kills. The sword brings forth death, which is darkness. Okay? That's what these illuminated Edomites live by. The sword. And Esau, period. The sword, per se. Right? Okay? Their helplessness and their staunch faith in God gave rise to several messianic movements, the most important of which was that of Sabbatai Zevi. You hear that? Their faith in God, their religious fervor. Yes, that'll be a bunch of nonsense, right? But again, he who's got the power writes the history. You follow me? And this is more like, you know, this is done under Edomite auspices, this history here. The rise of capitalism improved the condition of the Jews. You hear that? The rise of capitalism improved the condition of the Jews throughout Europe, while the revolutionary sentiments at the end of the 18th century also contributed towards a more liberal attitude by most governments. Political emancipation of the Jews began with the American and French revolutions. You hear that? 1789, the French Revolution with the Illuminati Edomite planned it out and instigated it and it was carried out. That was their first, great experiment in revolution. You understand? That succeeded. You know, because they were instigating others. Okay? It says, in Germany and Austria, emancipation of the Jews was proclaimed after the revolution of 1848. In Russia, birthplace of the pogrom, equal rights were granted them only after the Russian Revolution of 1917, after they disposed of the Romanov dynasty in 1916, wiped them out, which Nathan Rothschild had swore they was going to do 100 years earlier in 1815, when the Romanov dynasty dynamited, you understand, the League of Nations that they tried to get instituted when they brought Napoleon back a second time and got control of Britain and got control of the Bank of England. You understand, the Illuminati Edomite. Okay? Again, the House of Rothschild, and it was other Edomite families with them. Okay? Soviet Russia established an autonomous Jewish state in remote Birobian, autonomous, established an autonomous Jewish state in remote Birobizan. I guess I'm pronouncing that right, Birobidzhan. Though Judaism was until 1936 prescribed like all religion, okay? In Romania, Jews gained equal rights only at the end of the First World War. The gradual emancipation of the Jews brought forth two opposed movements. Cultural assimilation, okay, begun by Moses Mendelssohn, and Zionism, founded by Theodor Herzl in 1896. Okay? Now, you understand? Now, you reading about these Jews coming up through history, okay, over these centuries. Well, that's not the history of Israel. Israel was to be walking dead. We were to forget who we were. As we see still to this day, the majority of Israel still doesn't know that they're Israel, because they are not sought Yah, right? So, again, you follow what I'm saying? These people who are called the Jews, these people who you can track historically coming up through time, you follow what I'm saying? These people who went into economics and capitalism, as I just read, right, in these nations where they migrated into, because they weren't taken into these areas as captives. They migrated into these different countries. See, this is why they're not Israel. This is why they are the descendants of Esau. Okay? And this is why, again, you know, I'm going to come back here to this chapter 47, but I'm going to go over here to this, you know, in your book of Yeshaya, but I'm going to go over here to this Ezekiel, right, 35, to read about Esau. And again, when they use the terminology that the Edomites became scapegoats, you understand, in these different nations, when these nations experienced, you know, economic problems, right? To read it verbatim, what did it say? Wait a minute, let me, because I want to get it. I want to read it verbatim, just how they got it here. It says, when a country suffered economically or in war, its Jews were likely to be its scapegoat. You follow what I'm saying? But again, that, you understand, the people, you know, over a period of time ended up coming to understand that it was these Jews, these Edomites, you follow me, who were bringing this economic collapse, bringing this war mongering situation upon them. And that's when they would rise up against these Edomites, huh, and run them out of the country, as I just read and have read before. Now, look at what Yah says here in Ezekiel chapter 35. Moreover, the word of Yah came unto me, saying, this is Yah talking through Ezekiel, right? Son of man, set thy face against Mount Seir and prophesy against it, and say unto it, thus saith the Lord Yah, behold, O Mount Seir, I am against thee, and I will stretch out my hand against thee, and will make thee most desolate. I will lay thy cities waste, and you shall be desolate, and you shall know that I am Yah, because you have had a perpetual hatred and have shed the blood of the children of Israel by the force of the sword in the time of their calamity, in the time that their iniquity had an end. Therefore, as I live, saith the Lord Yah, I will prepare thee unto blood, and blood shall pursue thee. Since you have not hated blood, even blood shall pursue thee. Thus will I make Mount Seir most desolate, and cut off from it him that passes out and him that returns. And I will fill his mounts with his slain men. You hear that? In his land, not in Israel. In thy hills and in thy valleys and in all thy rivers shall they fall that are slain with the sword. I will make thee perpetual desolations, and thy city shall not return. Right? The land is there, but no cities are there, Esau, right? And ye shall know that I am he who creates, or that I am Yah, because you have said, these two nations and these two countries shall be mine, and we will possess it, whereas Yah was there. Okay? That's what they said in their heart back in 586 BCE when they came up with the Chaldean Babylonians, right? And you understand, 137 Psalm at the bottom, when the Edomites said, raise it, even to the foundation. They're talking about Yah's temple. Nebuchadnezzar burned it down. That wasn't enough for them. They said, raise the foundation. We don't want any remembrance of Yah left here in Jerusalem or in the world. See? Now, okay? Thou hast said these two. Okay, I just read that, right? Verse 11. Therefore, as I live, saith the Lord Yah, I will even do according to thine anger and according to thine envy, which you have used out of thy hatred against them, Israel, right? And I will make myself known among them when I have judged thee. You hear that? Yah's going to make himself known amongst his people who haven't awakened, who don't know who they are, who haven't sought Yah out, when he has judged the descendants of Esau. See? And again, how's he going to do that? Again, you try chapter 60. When he judges the Edomites, drives them out of the land of Israel suddenly into their land and burn them up, that's when these elite are going to come to the movement of Yah, our righteousness, the king, and acknowledge Yah and submit and humble themselves, these kings and these queens and these princes and other Gentiles who are knowledgeable, right? And thou shalt know that I am Yah, that I have heard all thy blasphemies which you have spoken against the mountains of Israel, saying, they are laid desolate. They are given us to consume. Thus with your mouth you have boasted against me and have multiplied your words against me. I have heard them. Thus saith the Lord Yah, when the whole earth rejoices, I will make thee desolate, as you did rejoice at the inheritance of the house of Israel, because it was desolate, so will I do unto thee. Thou shalt be desolate, O Mount Seir, and all Edomia, even all of it. And they shall know that I am he who creates, or that I am Yah. Now that's Ezekiel 35.